Good evening and welcome to Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Not long after the 9/11 attacks, Dr. Zuhdi Jasser became an outspoken voice against Islamic terrorists. In a statement released yesterday, Jasser called the killing of Osama bin Laden a victory for the U.S. against the face of Islamic terror. Earlier, I spoke with Dr. Zuhdi Jasser, president and founder of the American Islamic Forum for Democracy. Doctor, thank you for being here. We appreciate it.
It's a pleasure.
Your first thoughts when you heard the news about Osama bin Laden?
It was a sense of relief, a sense of victory. You know, as a former naval officer, our 9/11 families not only suffered the ultimate sacrifice, but we've had many of our sons and daughters in the military going to Afghanistan and Iraq. And this was the mission. It was to find bin Laden and bring him to justice, and that's what we did by killing him. And I think ultimately it'll allow us to close the chapter on bin Laden and move forward to really countering the ideology that created him.
I want to get to that ideology in a second here, but were you surprised where he was found?
It's always been said that he's either in Afghanistan or Pakistan, but the way he was found in a mansion, in a large home compound that should have been obvious, really, I think if anything comes out of this, we should realize that this old paradigm that you either are ally or you are enemy, this binary equation, just because our enemies does not mean that they're our friends. And I think Pakistan has proven that either Zardari doesn't have control of his country, or he's been complicit, or his intelligence services have been complicit, which is really what we're finding. And I think the administration was very wise in not telling Pakistan until after we did it, an operation on their soil, which says a lot for an ally, that we did the operation and then let them know that we did it.
Indeed. As far as what you're hearing from other Arab Americans, both here in the Valley and around the country, what is the reaction? What are you hearing?
Basically, elation, relief that this can move on, that the icon of bin Laden as representing a so-called Muslim, which many of us obviously not only feel he's not, but he is our enemy. He's killed, his first targets have been moderate Muslims. So this guy is evil. He has been in our community and as Muslims. I can't tell you how relieved we are, and most Muslims I've spoken to and Arabs are glad to see him put to rest and come to justice. And, you know, we're just like any other Americans. We are happy to see vindication and victory in this.
Is there a sense of liberation, kind of, in the sense that this person you mentioned, who is almost personified something that, you know, Muslims aren't in America, it's just get rid of the guy, it's over, that aspect of it?
Very much so, because, you know, since 9/11, with the videos that came after it, America looked upon bin Laden as the enemy. He declared war against us in 1998 and then did the act, so he became the war. And now I think we can close the chapter. We can say that it's not about bin Laden, it's about the ideologies that created him, and in many ways feel a sense of satisfaction that we have accomplished that mission, that we went, we found him, and brought him to justice.
Talk about the ideologies and whether or not in a changing, let's stick with the Arab world as far as the Muslim world is concerned, all sorts of upheaval there, lots of new ideas with democracy, lots of new ideas with getting rid of dictators, all this kind of business is going on there. Is Al-Qaeda, was Osama bin Laden old news in that region?
That's a great question, because if you look at the threat, homegrown terrorism has been more of a threat to the United States than ever before. As I testified to Congress in March, we have had more acts against our homeland by homegrown. Remember, bin Laden was a foreign operation. Homegrown terrorism now is a real threat, from Portland to Baltimore to Nidal Hassan's attack at Fort Hood to the Times Square bomber, the Christmas bomber. These have all just been in the last 2 years, stimulated by Imam Awlaki, by folks like Adam Gadan, other proteges of bin Laden, and other groups that have metastasized from Al-Qaeda. So we can't look upon bin Laden as the end of the war, that now we're done. It is actually, we're at more of a threat than ever before. The Middle East is very tumultuous. I'll tell you, first of all, that Al-Qaeda and radical Islam is a product of the dictatorships in the Middle East. We may have thought that it was stable, but in effect, the dictatorship of Mubarak produced the Brotherhood and the radical Islamists from it. The dictatorship of the monarchy in Saudi Arabia has produced Wahhabism and the Al-Qaeda from it. So if we're going to reform and bring modernity, what's happening, the upheaval, the economic upheaval, the democracy movements and uprising that we're seeing are going to be part of that process. But we may see some steps backwards. I mean, Syria is devolving into possibly a civil war now, and Libya is also. But this is good. I mean, my family came to the U.S. from Syria because we could practice our faith more freely here than in Syria. But if they're going to get towards democracy and freedom, they have to get rid of the thugs like Assad and the dictators.
You mentioned maybe taking a couple steps back then. The death of Osama bin Laden, is that we could see retaliation. We might see certain strikes here and there. Again, in what's playing in Syria and what's playing in Libya, does this death factor much, or is that a little bit of is he old news in that region?
You know, they're going to look for reasons to attack our homeland, to attack American citizens. Yes, we should be more vigilant. After this operation that happened, they may act. But they were using the royal wedding 4 days ago as an excuse to act. They were using other events that we have to act against our assets and our citizens. So this is a constant war. We need to be constantly vigilant and not to be concerned about doing the right thing, which is what our SEALs did.
What do you make of what we did after the death with the burial at sea? What do you make of that?
I'll tell you, as a Muslim, I was offended to think that our government wants to somehow give this evil monster a Islamic burial. I have yet to meet a Muslim that I've talked to. You ask me, what they think. None of them would ever say a prayer verse over his body. We never talked about that with Saddam Hussein, him getting an Islamic burial. Neither would any Muslims that are self-respecting think about having a funeral for the dead for him from an Islamic standpoint. We should have just, I think dumping him at sea was a good idea. You don't want him to have a burial place that he could become a martyr and become a monument for his jihadist movement. But at the end of the day, I was a Navy doc, and I read today about a Navy seaman that was a Muslim that read his Arabic scripture. If my CO had asked me to read my Quran over him, I would have done everything I could to refuse that order.
Interesting. Last question. How big is this news in general? Obviously a cathartic experience for Americans, but around the world, including America, how big is this?
I think if you look at 9/11, it was not the first salvo in the war against radical Islam, which started back from 1979, but it was big news. It was us waking up to the threat of radical Islam. The death of Osama bin Laden, the capture of him, is big news because he was the mastermind behind that plot. And I think especially for 9/11 families, we don't even have a valid monument yet at 9/11, and I think this will allow that chapter to close. It's very big news. Is it big as far as the threat, as far as the global security status and what our son and daughters are fighting in Afghanistan, Iraq, and in our homeland security? Not really. He's almost irrelevant in Al-Qaeda, almost irrelevant as far as security is concerned. But in the story, in the narrative against Al-Qaeda, it's a body blow, and it's a significantly big event looking at now almost 10 years since 9/11.
Dr. Jasser, good to have you on the show. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Joining me now with his perspective on the death of Osama bin Laden is ASU professor Steve Corman, who has served as a Defense Department consultant in the counterterrorism arena. He directs the Consortium for Strategic Communication and ASU's Hugh Down School of Human Communication. It's a group involved in countering ideological support for terrorism. Good to see you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Ted. Happy to be here.
Psychological implications of the death of Osama bin Laden.
Well, it kind of depends on who you are. So the reactions we've seen have run the gamut. So probably the most prevalent one, especially in the early going, was outright disbelief that Osama had been killed. And they're expressing disbelief. They think it's Western media propaganda. They won't believe it actually happened until al-Zawahiri comes out and gives a eulogy, that sort of thing.
The idea of being buried at sea, I'm sure, gets the conspiracy theorists just ratcheted up that much more.
Of course, there's no body to show, no pictures have been released yet, so all kinds of conspiracy theories can bloom.
Let's talk about the symbolic importance of bin Laden's death.
Well, symbolically, it's very important, first of all, for Al-Qaeda. So many of the extremists, for many of the extremists, he was a charismatic figure. They believed he enjoyed special protection from God, going back to the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, where he miraculously escaped being killed several times. And obviously now that's not true. And another thing is the seeming irrelevance of al-Qaeda in the recent uprisings in the Middle East. You know, Obama had been trying for 20 years to get rid of Mubarak and people like him who they considered apostate leaders in the Middle East. And in all that time of trying, here in 2 weeks, youth movement ousts the leader. And so all of this, I think, is contributing to a seeming marginalization of al-Qaeda in these sorts of Muslim affairs.
Yeah, we had talked about that earlier in the show. It almost seems as though Osama bin Laden is old news in some parts of the Muslim world.
In some parts, but for a dedicated cadre of followers, you know, he was really an important leader. And so I think the psychological impact of that in the long term is going to be a big loss to the organization.
Let's talk about operational standpoint and what you're seeing there. Again, if al-Qaeda's influence is a bit on the wane, the loss of Osama bin Laden, in terms of al-Qaeda's overall operation, what kind of impact?
Well, most people agree that for, you know, many years he hasn't been very heavily involved in operations of the group, and the fact that he was caught in a compound with no telecommunication, you know, makes it pretty unlikely that he was heavily involved in actually planning operations. So from that point of view, it's probably not going to affect the organization very much. It's unlikely to disrupt plans that had been already in place for attacks.
I was going to say, everyone is seeming to think that there's going to be some retaliation or attempts at retaliation. Is that a pretty safe bet here in the near future?
I would be very surprised if it didn't happen, because probably the second most prevalent reaction that we've seen on the in the Arab media and on the extremist websites are calls for revenge. And they say, if you crusaders think you have killed Obama and stopped al-Qaeda, there are 1,000 Osamas ready to take his place. And you know, we're coming for you.
In general, the Arab media, the Muslim media, and we can get to the extremist websites as well, but just in general, how is the story being told? What's that narrative like?
Well, it's that range of reactions from disbelief to calls from revenge. I mean, one thing that kind of surprised me was the number of negative statements about bin Laden that we've seen. So several people have said, you know, basically he was an embarrassment to Islam, he was responsible for the killing of thousands of Muslims, and he got what he deserved. So it's really run the gamut. One interesting thing is a contact in Pakistan told me today that the media there has been reporting his death in terms usually reserved for the death of non-Muslims. So that's sort of an interesting development.
Oh, it sure is. The extremist websites, I imagine, are pretty much churning out the same old, correct?
Yeah, of course. It's again, disbelief, calls for revenge, calls to carry on.
I know your research has studied the story, the narrative and the storytelling aspect of what some of these extremist sites and extremist folks are trying to do to get people to join their cause.
Right.
Talk to us about that. And again, how has that changed with this news?
Well, one of the most prominent narratives used is the Crusader narrative, and of course that refers to invasions of Muslim lands in the 10th through 12th centuries. And they use that as sort of an analogy for what's going on today, and so they try to cast the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan, for example, as an extension of the Crusades. I think one thing this does to that particular narrative is it shows that the United States is accomplishing what it set out to do in Afghanistan, and that combined with talks of leaving soon or starting to withdraw troops sort of complicates that narrative for the Islamist groups.
I was going to ask regarding the death of bin Laden and the way it was done, with really just a superb operation as far as this whole thing was concerned. The general war on terror, countries more, perhaps less inclined to help us? How do you see that dynamic?
Well, one thing that's interesting is that today there have been some calls out of the region saying, well, basically you've accomplished your objective, you have you've captured bin Laden, now it's time to leave. Mm. Another thing is the whole issue of how bin Laden could have existed in this compound 60 miles from the capital, closer to India than it is to Afghanistan, and nowhere near near the federally administrated tribal areas, how he could have operated in that fashion for so long without the Pakistani government knowing about it. They had a military academy near the place he was staying. So I think that's probably going to complicate relations with the Pakistanis.
I was going to add, were you surprised that that's where they found this guy?
I really was. I mean, ever since the Tora Bora battles, people thought he escaped to the badlands on the Afghan-Pakistan border, and now we find him 60 miles from the capital. It's kind of amazing.
What do you think this does now to U.S.-Pakistani relations and Pakistan's standing really in the world? I mean, they've got some splaining to do here.
Yeah, I agree. And I've heard a number of government officials, including Colin Powell just this afternoon, express the same sentiment. And are they really for us or against us? And how dependable are these people in the struggle against these extremist groups?
And what do you think is going to happen here? Again, when you monitor some of the websites and monitor some of the extremist groups, how does Pakistan's position after this information comes out? I mean, you got one of two things here. Either Pakistan knew he was there and did nothing about it, or the entire military complex there is so inept that the guy can stay in the biggest house in town and no one even knows about it.
Right. Well, I think part of it is that we haven't heard the whole story yet. So I've heard some suggestions that the Pakistani intelligence service was on site when the raid took place. Contra to what the administration said yesterday. So I think a few more days will be required to see how this all rolls out, but it probably doesn't bode well for U.S.-Pakistani relations.
All right. Steve, good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure, Ted.